Greetings. This is Ron Aledo, former CIA contractor analyst. Today I'm going to talk to you about Syria. It's in the news. It's a very hot topic right now. So I'm going to put my two cents into the situation in Syria. The first thing, according to analysis of competing hypotheses, we cannot right now remove from the table the hypothesis of a false flag. We cannot do that. There is no evidence that force us to remove that hypothesis. So we need to keep it on the table right now. It's a real possibility that that chemical attack was a false flag. That means that it was not the Syrian government, but somebody else trying to blame the Syrian government. So we need to keep that on the table, and we need to understand a few things about it. First, it makes no sense for the Syrian government to use the chemical weapons. From the strategic viewpoint, strategic interest, it makes no sense at all that for them to use these weapons right now when they're winning the war. 95% of the war is already won. I mean, there are a few pockets of resistance there, of terrorists, of Islamists here and there, but 90-95% of the war is already won. They are recovering the whole territory of the Syrian Republic, with the exception of those controlled by the United States and its proxies, and now Turkey and its proxies in the north. But other than that, they are winning. So it makes no sense to risk everything just for using these chemical weapons. Number two, they are not supposed to have these weapons. They were destroyed, remember? John Kerry and Obama back in 2013, making this deal with the Russian government that they will take all chemical weapons of Syria, remove them from the country, destroy them, etc. So they are using against their own interests, according to the theory, I mean to the hypothesis, official hypothesis, they are using against all interests, all their own strategic interests, weapons that they don't have. So let's keep that in mind. They are not supposed to have any chemical weapon, according to John Kerry. And the certification of the U.S. Department of State 5 years ago, they were all destroyed, removed and destroyed. So now let's going to think, who can benefit from this false flag? Who can benefit? A few actors can benefit. Firstly, the terrorists can benefit. Remember, it's a very complex issue, the war in Syria. There are many, many actors. And yes, ISIS, Daesh, and Al-Qaeda, they are the most famous ones, the most brutal ones. But there are dozens of other groups. Hardcore, Islamist, jihadist groups, dozens of them. And it makes sense that one of these groups that are losing the war, they are desperate, they are losing everything, they are about to be annihilated by the Syrian army, that they launch this attack. They have the weapons. The intelligence knows that. They have these weapons. There are pictures in YouTube. There are pictures on the open press that say that this group, they have these weapons. So it's very possible that one of these groups use these weapons against other group with the intention and with the hope that somebody will blame the Syrian government. That's very possible. It's a hypothesis, but it's a very credible hypothesis. So the terrorist groups, those supported by Saudi Arabia, by Qatar, by Turkey, it's very possible that one of those terrorist groups use the weapons. So they are an actor that will benefit from this false flag. In the United States, the neocons, the Warren Hawks neocons, John McCain, Lindsey Graham, all those neocons of the Bush era that are still there, present in the Republican Party. So those guys, they see themselves as the rulers of the Middle East, the rulers actually of the world. They are happy triggers. They shoot first, then they ask questions later. So it's possible that these groups also will benefit. Their policy, their worldview, their warmongering worldview will benefit from this issue. In Israel, the hardcore right-wing guys of the Likud and other minority parties to the right of the Likud, they might also benefit from this. Because attacking the Syrian government can be understood as an attack on Iran. And Iran is the arch enemy of perceived arch enemy of the right wing in Israel. So if they attack the United States and the West, they attack Syria, then the benefit is that Hezbollah in Lebanon might not get that permanent supply route that they also want so much. And remember, the power of Iran goes from Iran to Iraq to Syria, all the way to Lebanon. So by weakening the Syrian government, right now some actors gain by weakening Iran. So that's another possibility. Also, we need to understand that another actor that benefits from this false flag is Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, while officially against terrorism and against these jihadist groups, etc., in one way or another, either the government or the population, the private entities of Saudi Arabia, they have been supporting the terrorists in Syria for years and years. Dozens or perhaps hundreds of millions of dollars from Saudi Arabia have gone to those terrorist groups in Syria. Remember, Daesh and Al-Qaeda, there are only two groups. But there are dozens of other groups that are Sunni groups, 100% loyal to Saudi Arabia, radical Sunni Muslims, and they have been supported by Saudi Arabia with the only intention of destroy the Syrian government and destroy the Shia Alawite Christian influence in Syria. So Saudi Arabia and Qatar also, they benefit from this false flag. So those are the actors who might benefit from this false flag. We need to keep that in mind. Some people is saying, is this the beginning of World War III, of a nuclear holocaust? I don't think so. I don't think this is a healthy step in the right direction. Obviously, it is not a healthy step on the right direction, but it's not like the beginning of World War III. I can recall a couple of years ago what Hillary Clinton was promising. She was promising, I will make a no-fly zone in Syria. That would mean a serious escalation in World War III, because that no-fly zone that Hillary Clinton promised was shooting down, on purpose, Russian planes. The American military, under order of President Clinton, Hillary Clinton, taking down on purpose Syrian planes, Russian planes. That's an act of war. And obviously after that, Russia will have to retaliate, and then the United States will retaliate more, then Russia will retaliate more, and suddenly everybody will be looking at who's going to begin the retaliation in Poland and the Baltics. And that nuclear trigger will become a hair trigger that any moment can go on. That will be serious threat for World War III. The Hillary Clinton plan and the John McCain plan of a no-fly zone in Syria, that will be a real escalation into a nuclear holocaust. I don't think this is going to be like that. Obviously, it's not a step in the right direction, but it's nothing like that. Remember, only the Russian ambassador to Lebanon has said that Russia might or will retaliate against a U.S. attack on Syrian on the Syrian military. There is not an official clear statement from the Russian government saying in a very clear, unequivocal way that they will retaliate. There is not in the open sources that I look at, there is nothing like that. There is a strategic ambivalence of what they would do or what they might do once they attack the Syrian military. Remember, an attack like this happened a year ago and there was no further escalation. So let's hope if this attack happens that there is no further escalation either this time. The only thing that I see as a real danger here is that by accident or by not so much an accident, a few Russian soldiers die. Russian plane get destroyed on the ground. Russian command center or command post get destroyed. And you see 5-10 Russian military men dying. Or perhaps a Russian colonel or general dying. Then I see this very bad escalating, going fast up to the worse, from bad to worse. If that happens, then the right wing, the conservative nationalists in Russia, those parties that are to the right of Putin, Vladimir Zhirinovsky, all the ultra-nationalist groups, they will demand to Putin retaliation against the United States. And then things might go really, really bad. Then I will get really nervous if that happens, because then the United Russia will use those S-400 air defenses against Russian American planes, and things can get bad really easy. So it's obviously it's a dangerous scenario. I don't think it's the end of the war. I don't think it's World War III yet. We're far from that, but obviously it can escalate. So let's hope it doesn't escalate. And the last question, the last point I want to make clear is, what's going on? Why is Trump doing that? Okay? Remember, a lot of people that supported Trump, they supported because they saw him, the anti-neocon, the non-neocon, warmonger Republican, a conservative, American first foreign policy that did not play into the neocon's worldview of World War III, Cold War II, etc. So there are a few hypotheses here. Number one, remember, the press in the United States, all the main media, the press, TV and internet, all the newspapers, they hate Trump. They hate him so much. They despise him. I mean, it's satanic level of hate. Hatred, but they have towards Trump, okay? The New York Times, Washington Post, CNN, they hate him. They hate him with rage. So they accuse him all the time of him being submissive to Putin, submissive to Russia, that he won the elections thanks to Russia, etc. That's their narrative, left-wing, Trump-hating narrative. So one thing that might be influencing Trump right now is showing to that press that hate him so much that he is not that he's not submissive to Russia, that he has his own interest, his own foreign policy. Another thing, you have to understand that the Republican Party is split on two. There is the moderate faction of the Republican Party, the neocons, the globalists, if you want to call it that, like that, the John McCain, Lindsey Graham, the Bush family, faction of the Republican Party, that they are pro-war, they hate Trump, they are too much centrist and too much moderate to support Trump. They reject Trump nationalism, they reject Trump's policies toward the deep America, towards the working class America, and they hate him. They are what we call the never Trumpers. Before Trump got elected, the Republican Party, these neocons in the Republican Party, they got together and they swore to each other, we will never, ever support Trump. We will never, ever allow Trump to become president. And they are not Democrats. They are not left-wing socialists. They are Republicans. They are inside the Republican Party. So one thing that might gain a truce, at least, a peace, a temporary peace to Trump, with these neocons, with this moderate centrist John McCain faction of the Republican Party, will be an action like this, attacking Syria. That is music to the ears of the neocons. That is ecstasy to the ears of the neocons. That's heaven for them, heaven on earth. whenever the United States attacks and bombs here and destroys there, and they love that. So that's a point that we need to understand. That's a point that we need to keep on mind. Maybe Trump is trying to make a truce, a peace with those neocons. So let's try to understand that. There is a lot of people pressuring Trump to do this because they want to see the Syrian government destroyed. They want to see the Syrian government removed. Not because the Syrian government, they care about the Syrian government at all. Because the Syrian government is aligned with Iran. And remember, there is a civil war in the Middle East. Iran against Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the leader of the Sunnis, and Iran is the leader of the Shias. There is a brutal war over there going. A proxy is an economical war. It's a political war. It's a religious war. Each team accuses the other team to be the heretics, to be the bad guys, the non-true Muslims. So they hate each other. So they are right now doing a proxy war, a cold war inside the Middle East between Iran and Saudi Arabia. And many people in the United States support the Saudi position because they see the Saudis as safer. At least the Saudi government, not the Saudi followers, the Sunnis around the jihadists, but the Saudi government are safer to the West, and especially safer to Israel. So a lot of people in Washington, want to destroy Iran to support other interests. And they see like weakening Syria a proxy way to weaken or destroy Iran. Now, this is my personal opinion, but I think that as a Christian, we need to consider one important point. The best bet to support and defend the Christians in Syria right now is the Syrian government, period. No one else cares about the Christian community, about the Orthodox over there, about the very old Christian communities of Syria, about 10% of the population. Nobody else cares about them. But the Syrian government, there are Christians in the Syrian army, there are Christians in the Syrian government. All the Christian militias have been fighting side to side with the Syrian government. So we need to understand that. The Sunni jihadis, they are going to kill them all. They don't care. The proxies of Turkey, the Kurdish, they don't care. The only people who is defending and protecting the Christians in Syria is the Syrian government. So let's keep that in mind. I recommend people to keep listening to those voices that are denouncing the false flag. Ron Paul, let's listen to his shows in YouTube, in the news. Ron Paul is talking a lot of sense in this issue. Even Fox News, Tucker Carlson. Tucker Carlson, he did a very brilliant explanation of this false flag 2 days ago, actually 3 days ago in Fox News. Let's go to YouTube and listen to Tucker Carlson pointing to the hypothesis of false flag. I mean, obviously the neocons will go on rage, furious. But Tucker Carlson, listen to what he said. He said, he mentioned some very smart, very analytical points about this false flag. So let's listen to them and let's keep in mind that for the benefit of our community, and when I say our community, I'm talking about the Christian community, for the benefit of the Christian community, the best bet for them, for their safety and protection, is the Syrian government. Thank you very much. Let's see what happens in the next days. Thanks.